I'm quite honored to be here. And I have to say, I think it's hard to think of a more urgent set of issues than the ones we're asked to be thinking about at this conference today. I'm going to focus on the third of the three questions that we're asked to consider with respect to first use of nuclear weapons. The third question is it just? Namely, is it morally right? And because this question applies not only to presidential first use, I think, but to first use by any state or non-state actor. And I want to begin with an ancient motto that has now taken on an ominous new meaning. Fiat justitia, pereat mundus. Let justice be done, though the world should perish. Sometimes this motto is phrased as fiat justitia ruat caelum. Let justice be done, though the sky should fall. Both mottos urge that you should do what is right, no matter how horrendous the circumstances and the consequences might be for you. Now, in the 16th century, Emperor Ferdinand I of the Holy Roman Empire chose that first motto as his own, and he used it as his armies fought the invading forces of the Ottomans led by Suleiman the Magnificent. But ferocious as those battles were, Ferdinand could never have imagined that the world would perish as a result of his fighting, and his fighting of what he thought were just wars. But since Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the metaphors of the world perishing or the sky falling have taken on far more literal meanings. So as we think about justice and war today, there are three main views about that. One is the realist view, so-called, that war is hell, that justice is not an issue in war, and it never has been. Then there is the pacifist view, that wars are never just. But then there is the view also called just war theory. And that is that there can be just wars if they are waged for justifiable purposes, such as national self-defense, but only if going to war is a last resort, and never if it explicitly targets non-combatants or uses inhumane weapons. Now, these conditions cannot be met by nuclear wars. Such wars would obliterate the line between self-defense and aggression, as well as the distinction between combatants and non-combatants, and between more or less inhumane weapons. So Michael Walzer, in his famous book, Just and Unjust Wars, put it this way. Nuclear weapons explode the theory of just war. Well, any use of nuclear weapons at all is unjust, since it endangers vast numbers of civilians and employs the most inhumane of weapons. But any first use of such weapons is precisely also not launched as a last resort. So then the question arises, can we say the same thing about policies that just warn or threaten the resort to nuclear weapons? Policies that permit first use for defensive purposes in order to reinforce deterrence. Precisely so as to prevent or forestall any actual use of such weapons. And I think that is an argument that we will be talking about more today. Proponents of first use argue that there should be no moral constraints on what a nation can do or threaten in self-defense, and that's quite different from actually doing it. Ordinary moral constraints should allow for limited exceptions as a last resort when self-defense is at issue. Invoking self-defense as justification for going to war rests on a long-standing analogy between nations defending themselves and individuals doing so by means of violence as a last resort if need be. But we need look no farther back than to the wars in Vietnam and Iraq to see misuses of that language of self-defense. Misuses that ended up having the United States and others violating the most basic moral constraints regarding engaging in war as a last resort and in a way that spares civilians and prohibits inhumane weapons. Well, just as rulers in past wars once took for granted that God was on their side, so self-defense and national security are invoked today even for aggressive ventures far beyond national borders. And such actions are hardly analogous to what an individual might rightfully do as a last resort when faced with direct assault. And because of the ferocity of today's weapons and the genuine threat to national survival, governments now often argue that everything they do to reinforce their own power and that of their allies, or to diminish that of their enemies, actually does contribute to self-defense. Now, during the 1980s, when the world lived with the balance of terror between NATO, including the United States, and the Soviet Union, NATO insisted on retaining a policy of first use. They argued that nuclear deterrence by itself might not suffice if Soviet conventional forces moved into Europe. NATO would then have no way to guard against such a move without relying on the threat of first use of nuclear weapons. At the same time, as many of us remember, there was growing unrest in Europe caused by the fear that the great powers intended for Europe to be the theater, so-called, where they would clash. Peace movements were mobilizing, calls were made for more complete test bans, for nuclear-free zones, for the elimination of uses of cruel weapons and cruel methods of warfare, and for the rejection of first-use policies. And then in 1982, an influential article was published by George Bundy, George Kennan, Robert McNamara, and Gerard Smith that urged that the time had come for NATO to reconsider the policy of first use. And I quote them, they said, "We think a policy of no first use, especially shared with the Soviet Union, would bring new hope to everyone in every country whose life is shadowed by the hideous possibility of a third great 20th century conflict in Europe, conventional or nuclear," they added. Now, 35 years later, the fear of the third great conflict to which they referred as a hideous possibility has recurred. Kofi Annan recently recalled in a speech that he was Secretary General of the United Nations at the time of the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989. And now the feeling of great relief and a sudden sense with the end of the Cold War that the UN could again do much of what it was set out to do without one country always vetoing the other. And with world leaders realizing that cross-border cooperation was the only way to solve crises. Yet now, Annan said, we seem to be back where we were before 1989. And he said, men in high places don't always seem to understand the risks we are in. All that we need is one miscalculation and all bets are off. That same sense of urgency and of high risk was expressed by the Norwegian Nobel Committee when awarding the Nobel Peace Prize for 2017 to the International Committee to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, ICAN, or ICAN, as you might say in Norwegian. We live in a world, they said, where the risk of nuclear weapons being used is greater than it has been for a long time. And here I think we echo what we have just been hearing. It's a time when the number of states having nuclear weapons has increased, and risks have increased still more. And a time also of intense distrust among nuclear adversaries. There is greater risk than ever that nuclear weapons might be launched not necessarily on purpose in any sense, but accidentally, or in error, or utterly irrationally. And this is why it's so important, I think, to consider the role that having or rejecting a first use doctrine, as we are doing today, is, as I said, so important. And just as the popular movements in Europe contributed to public debate and to bringing about change during the 1980s, so ICANN, or ECANN, is joining with so many other groups, environmental, all kinds of other groups, to work for the same goals with its efforts to achieve a treaty-based prohibition of nuclear weapons, and by drawing attention to the catastrophic consequences for the peoples of the world of any use of such weapons, first, second, or last. They all aim to raise awareness of what genuine concern for collective self-defense calls for on the part of peoples around the world. And here I would say, here's another use of the language of self-defense that we need to support and get back to, namely the collective self-defense of all the people who might be the victims, if nothing is done, of a horrendous catastrophe. So that is a crucial other use of the language of self-defense in addition to all the uses that are now being made to further power of the nuclear states. So I want to close with a joint declaration by President Reagan and General Secretary Gorbachev in 1985, that has been so often cited. And I wonder whether the two of them would not applaud all these many efforts, including our effort here today. And here's the quote: "A nuclear war can never be won and must never be fought." Thank you very much.